Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Scott, Bishop in the Church of God, on behalf of the clergy and people of the Diocese of Fort Worth, we present to you Mary Madeleine Hill to be ordained a priest in Christ's Holy Catholic Church.
Has she been selected in accordance with the canons of this church? And do you believe her manner of life to be suitable to the exercise of this ministry?
We certify to you that she has satisfied the requirements of the canons, and we believe her to be qualified for this order.
Maddie, will you be loyal to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of Christ as this church has received them? And will you, in accordance with the canons of this church, obey your bishop and other ministers who may have authority over you and your work?
I am willing and ready to do so, and I solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
Dear friends in Christ, you know the importance of this ministry and the weight of your responsibility in presenting Maddie for ordination to the sacred priesthood. Therefore, if any of you know any impediment or crime because of which we should not proceed, come forward now and make it known. Is it your will that we ordain Maddie a priest?
It is.
Will you uphold her in this ministry?
We will.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
God the Father,
have mercy on us.
God the Son,
have mercy on us.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us.
Holy Trinity, one God,
have mercy on us.
We pray to you, Lord Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in a true and godly life, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Scott, our bishop, Sam and Rayford, our assisting bishops, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be filled with your love, may hunger for truth, and may thirst after righteousness, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Maddie, chosen priest in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That she may faithfully fulfill the duties of this ministry, build up your church, and glorify your name, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, she may be sustained and encouraged to persevere to the end, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there's no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose blessed apostles Peter and Paul glorified you by their martyrdom, grant that your church, instructed by their teaching and example, and knit together in unity by your Spirit, may ever stand firm upon the one foundation, which is Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when some of his sheep have been scattered abroad, so will I seek out my sheep. And I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the fountains and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and upon the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on fat pasture they shall feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the crippled, and I will strengthen the weak and the fat and the strong. I will watch over. I will feed them in justice. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together the gradual Psalm 87. On the holy mountain stands the city he has founded. The Lord loves the gates of Zion. More than all the dwellings of Jacob. Glorious things are spoken of you, O city of our God. I count Egypt and Babylon among those who know me. Behold, Philistia, Tyre, and Ethiopia, in Zion were they born. Of Zion it shall be said, everyone was born in her, and the Most High himself shall sustain her. The Lord will record as he enrolls the peoples, those also were born there. The singers and the dancers will say, all my fresh springs are in you. A reading from Paul's second letter to Timothy. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who it is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be urgent in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, and exhort, be unfailing in patience and in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own likings, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. As for you, always be steady, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. For I am already on the point of being sacrificed. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
After his resurrection, Jesus revealed himself to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you girded yourself and walked where you would. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish to go." This he said to show what death he was to glorify God. And after this he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Maddie, Corey, welcome to the club. You've made it. You've arrived. You did it. Well done. Whoops, I'm sorry. I confused this with your graduation from seminary, or your graduation from college, or passing the bar, or being certified as a master plumber, or any other accomplishment. In fact, forget everything I just said. Because it turns out you are about to be ordained to the priesthood. And the priesthood is not a club, nor is the church a club. Being ordained to the priesthood is not an achievement. It is not an upwardly mobile career. It is a downwardly mobile vocation, which I'm sure you already know already, but there are many who are listening now who may not know that. There are many aspects of being a priest, far too many to roll into one ordination sermon, although I do recall one right here at All Saints about 25 years ago, which tried to do just that. It was one of those acrostic sermons, the kind nobody ever remembers, except for the acrostic. It started out with P, of course. P stood for something or other, I don't remember, and we all thought, yikes, we're in for a 6-point sermon. P-R-I-E-S-T, yep, 6 points, settle in. And then R stood for something else, and then on to I, which stood for such and such, and then E stood for this and that, and then S, which stood for who cares by now, and then finally T. Yay, T! And there was a palpable sense of relief when the preacher got to the T of priest. There was light at the end of the tunnel. The sermon was drawing to a close. As the preacher wrapped up his exposition on what the letter T meant in priest, he took a sip of water from the pulpit, and then he said, H. H. Oh no, not the dreaded H. This is not a sermon on the acrostic priest. It's a sermon on the acrostic priesthood. Hood. Why hood? By the way, this preacher loved acrostic sermons. He did the same thing on Mother's Day once. He launched into M and then O, T, H, E, R. And at the R, we all took in an apprehensive corporate breath, waiting, and then came the dreaded H, hood, motherhood. Everyone was late for Mother's Day brunch that Sunday. So no, I won't subject you to anything like that. No 21-point sermon on the acrostic, the order of Melchizedek. There is one and only one aspect of your life as an ordained priest that I want to touch on tonight. It is unity. Unity. And your part in that as a priest. In the collect for the feast day of Saints Peter and Paul today, we prayed this clause. Grant that your church, instructed by their teaching and example, and knit together in unity by your Spirit. There it is. Unity. We pray, therefore we believe, that the church is knit together in unity by God the Holy Spirit. The church which calls you, the church which ordains you, the church which you shall serve is one. And the church's oneness, its unity, its union is not man-made. The church is not a human institution. It is an institution full of humans, but the church, according to our prayers, is a divine institution because it is the handiwork of God, not of man. As today's prayer goes, we are knit together in unity by your Spirit, God. One of my favorite prayers, not surprisingly here at All Saints, is the Collect for All Saints Sunday. In this prayer, we pray in part this. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. There it is. Again, we the church are one communion. We the church are one fellowship. We the church are one mystical body knit together by whom? By God. We the church are God's handiwork. God has knit us into one giant, beautiful, variegated tapestry. This collect in which God knits the church into union is why I like to think of God as a weaver sitting at a loom, pulling threads of all colors and textures together into one majestic and glorious tapestry called the church. God the knitter, God the weaver, God the artisan, enjoying the variegated wholeness and unity of his handiwork, the church. So, what's our part in this? Well, to borrow words from our Lord Jesus Christ used in reference to another matter, those whom God has joined together, let no one rend asunder. God has joined us together, knit us together into one body, the church. And those whom God has joined together, let no one rend asunder. We, you and I, are more than capable of tearing apart God's handiwork, the church. And we are not to do that, are we? But what happens from time to time is we, threads in God's tapestry, we're sitting there being church, knit together by God, and after a while we look around and think, you know what? I don't much like the thread I'm knit so closely to. In fact, there's a lot of thread around here I don't much cotton to. Why am I, a blue thread, say, woven so closely to these red threads and those yellow threads and a bunch of green threads over there? It's, in fact, this whole rainbow of threads. I'm going to look around for threads more like me, some threads more to my liking, threads more to my taste. We threads of like mind, we'll just pull ourselves out of this far too variegated tapestry and reorganize over there somewhere into a tapestry more of our liking. That is tearing apart God's handiwork, rending asunder that which God has joined together. It's not all that difficult to find people who think like us. And with them, we can create clubs, we can form parties. But we must never think that in doing so, we are being church. We don't get to decide who's in and who's out of church. It is God who knits us together by His Holy Spirit. But we humans can definitely pull it apart. Unity. Maddie and Corey, we priests must never be a part of anything that rends God's tapestry, the church. Like all members of the church, we are stewards of God's tapestry. It is not ours, it is God's. To shift to another metaphor, we are stewards of God's flock. Tapestry, after all, can't really pull itself apart, but sheep can certainly get up and go. Again, the flock of which we are trustees isn't one of our making. The flock is of God's making, and we have been entrusted with its stewardship. And we're not really shepherds at all. God is the shepherd, as we heard in the lesson from Ezekiel today, and Jesus is the good shepherd. And you and I, we priests, are sheep, sheep like the rest of God's flock. We priests are steward sheep. As steward sheep, our job is not to scatter the flock. Our job, among a whole bunch of other things, is to keep the flock together. We are never to engage in or encourage any activity or behavior which causes the flock to be pulled apart and scattered. We are one. One tapestry, one flock, one body, pick your metaphor, made one by God. In our Eucharistic prayer D, as in David, we pray this. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ, reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Reveal its unity, we pray. We, God's church, are one. Reveal its unity. Maddie, Corey, revealing its unity is rarely achieved by taking a vote. Revealing the union God has crafted requires different approaches: discussion, listening, speaking, discerning, praying, but not always voting, and certainly not voting prematurely. In church, taking a vote can be an act of violence. A bloodless act of violence, yes, but an act of violence nonetheless, and therefore contrary to the nature and identity of the church. Are you with us or against us? Take a stand. Vote. Rather a shocking thing to hear in the United States of America, but how does the phrase, all in favor say aye, all opposed say nay, do anything but separate people? Separate the flock into winners and losers, those who prevailed and those who failed, an action, taking a stand, which can drive people out. And when they leave, although some may say good riddance, the union of God's handiwork is rent asunder. The union of God's flock is broken. And we all are impoverished by that brokenness, all of us, to the detriment of those who leave and to the detriment of those who stay. In response, some say, but taking a stand is prophetic, it is courageous. And yes, taking a stand drives some people out, but that's just part of the price we have to pay. And yes, some people leave over it, but it also attracts some people in. No doubt. But do not deceive yourself into thinking that by this you are doing anything more than crafting a party of like-minded people, not a church. And that by this you are forming a club of people of your own kind, not a church. When I was growing up, way back when, the Episcopal Church was labeled the Republican Party at Prayer, partly in jest, but uncomfortably close to the truth. And that really isn't church at all, is it? That is just what the label says, a political party at prayer. But we, the Episcopal Church, have a much older way of styling ourselves than the all-too-close-for-comfort moniker of a political party at prayer. We have called ourselves the Via Media, the Middle Way, Catholic and Reformed. We are not the Middle Way because we successfully drove out those with extreme Catholic and Protestant convictions. We are the Middle Way because we are the Catholic and the Protestant together. We're the Middle Way because we hold the spectrum together, even its most distal ends. At least that is what we have understood to be our vocation, and that is what we have aspired to do, to reveal the unity of God's church. The prayer I think best articulates this is the collect for the Feast of Richard Hooker on November 3rd. And here it is. O God of truth and peace, you raised up your servant Richard Hooker in a day of bitter controversy to defend with sound reasoning and great charity the Catholic and Reformed religion. Grant that we may maintain that middle way, not as a compromise for the sake of peace, but as a comprehension for the sake of truth. Our way, the middle way, the Via Media, is not a compromise. It is not a bit of this mixed with a dash of that. It is not the Elizabethan blend of Christian tea. And our way, the middle way, the Via Media, is not merely giving a little, going along to get along for the sake of peace. No. It is not peace alone which we are after, as lovely as that peace might be. We're after something more. We are after truth as well. In this collect we pray, therefore we must surely believe that our way, the middle way, the Via Media, is a comprehension for the sake of truth. We don't drive out the extremes and those whose views we do not share. We do not stake out the middle so we can have a bit of peace in this life. No. We comprehensively include all perspectives of goodwill, from way over there to way over there and everyone in between. And we do that with open arms. For the sake of what? For the sake of truth. Truth. Grant that we may maintain that middle way, not as a compromise for the sake of peace, but as a comprehension for the sake of truth. As we include all, as we listen to all, as we share all perspectives, we all come to see the truth more clearly, not just some of us, but all of us. Discerning truth is not about weeding out perspectives that don't agree with mine. Seeking truth is about listening to the truth as others see it, while sharing the truth as I see it. And we don't then vote on which of those perspectives is the true truth and toss all the others. That's the act of violence I mentioned earlier. No, when we hold all these perspectives together, we begin to see something that no one of us quite saw, something new emerging from the pooling of these variegated perspectives. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John each share their take, their perspective on the one truth, Jesus, don't they? Each of those perspectives is different, and each of those perspectives is true. Some perspectives sound very much at odds with other perspectives, particularly John. But when we hold all four perspectives together, we begin to see a fuller truth, a more complex truth, Jesus, which no one of them alone quite expressed. This is a comprehension for the sake of truth. On the other hand, when we stop listening and push that the church take a stand now, insist that the people take a vote now, and drive out those who don't see things our way, we have done nothing but build another club, another party of people who all see the truth from their very narrow tunnel vision perspective, a perspective which may well be true, but is only a tiny sliver of truth. Our way, the middle way, the via media, does not just tolerate different perspectives, it values them. It understands that it needs them. And in our comprehension, we begin to see a fuller truth, a truth built up from all the shards of truth which each perspective brings to the common vision, a comprehension for the sake of truth. Maddie and Corey, in your ministry as a priest in the church, you will be tempted by your personal convictions to take a stand. You will be asked by others to call for a vote, to pass a resolution, to urge the signing of a petition, asked by parishioners, asked by other priests, by bishops, by church conventions, and there will be times when that is a good and necessary thing to do. But do much of that as standing operating procedure and be ready to live with the results, the growth of more parties of like-minded people, and the atrophy of the church as a comprehension for the sake of truth. My conviction, one I doubt is shared by many listening now, and that's not a bad thing. My conviction is that being a priest, especially one who is entrusted as a steward of a portion of God's flock, requires more tongue-biting than talking, and more patience than performative wokeness. Maddie and Corey, when in the midst of the cacophony of calls to take a stand, here is my paradoxical advice. Take a stand. Yes, take a stand. To be priests who seek truth through comprehension, priests who facilitate conversation and listening, priests who move the flock from division to tolerance, from tolerance of others' perspectives to understanding those who differ, from understanding to appreciating the value of others' views, from merely appreciating disparate views to realizing the need we have as a body for holding together our variegated perspectives. That is participating in God's handiwork. That is being of use to God, like holding together the multicolored, multi-textured spools for God as God pulls them together, weaves them together, knits them together into God's handiwork, the rich tapestry of God's church. It is oddly prophetic to call the Episcopal Church to keep its identity, a church which welcomes all, even those with whom I or you or we disagree. And my hope and prayer for you, Maddie and Corey, is that you do just that, that you live out your vocation as priests who foster the church to refresh and remember and return to her aspirations, to be what we pray, to be what we say, to be what we believe, God's handiwork, knit together in unity, a comprehension for the sake of truth. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My sister, the church is the family of God, the body of Christ, and the temple of the Holy Spirit. All baptized people are called to make Christ known as Savior and Lord, and to share in the renewing of his world. Now you are called to work as a pastor, priest, and teacher, together with your bishop and fellow presbyters, and to take your share in the councils of the church. As a priest, it will be your task to proclaim by word and deed the gospel of Jesus Christ and to fashion your life in accordance with its precepts. You are to love and serve the people among whom you work, caring alike for young and old, strong and weak, rich and poor. You are to preach, to declare God's forgiveness to penitent sinners, to pronounce God's blessing, to share in the administration of holy baptism, and in the celebration of the mysteries of Christ's body and blood, and to perform the other ministrations entrusted to you. In all that you do, you are to nourish Christ's people from the riches of his grace and strengthen them to glorify God in this life and in the life to come. My sister, do you believe that you are truly called by God and his church to this priesthood?
I believe I am so called.
Do you now, in the presence of the church, commit yourself to this trust and responsibility?
I do.
Will you respect and be guided by the pastoral direction and leadership of your bishop?
I will.
Will you be diligent in the reading and study of the Holy Scriptures and in seeking the knowledge of such things as may make you a stronger and more able minister of Christ?
I will.
Will you endeavor so to minister the Word of God and the sacraments of the New Covenant that the reconciling love of Christ may be known and received?
I will.
Will you undertake to be a faithful pastor to all whom you are called to serve, laboring together with them and with your fellow ministers to build up the family of God?
I will.
Will you do your best to pattern your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ so that you may be a wholesome example to your people?
I will.
Will you labor to God through the mediation of Jesus Christ, persevere in prayer, both in public and in private, asking God's grace, both for yourself and for others, offering all your labors to God and in the sanctification of the Holy Spirit?
I will.
May the Lord, who has given you the will to do these things, give you the grace and power to perform them. God and Father of all, we praise you for your infinite love in calling us to be a holy people in the kingdom of your Son, Jesus our Lord, who is the image of your eternal and invisible glory, the firstborn among many brethren, and the head of the church. We thank you that by his death he has overcome death, and having ascended into heaven, has poured his gifts abundantly upon your people, making some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry and the building up of his body. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Maddie. Fill her with grace and power, and make her a priest in your church. May she exalt you, O Lord, in the midst of your people. Offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you. Boldly proclaim the gospel of salvation, and rightly administer the sacraments of the new covenant. Make her a faithful pastor, a patient teacher, and a wise counselor. Grant that in all things she may serve without reproach, so that your people may be strengthened and your name glorified in all the world. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Maddie, take the yoke of the Lord, for his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Maddie, receive this Bible as a sign of the authority given to you to preach the Word of God and to administer his holy sacraments. Do not forget the trust committed to you as a priest of the Church of God. Let's greet our new priest.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Maddie. Peace be with you.
Peace.
Want to give the blessing?
And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.